Well, a warm welcome, everyone, to this evening's Lissa Oration. My name is Professor Pauline Harris, and I'm Professor of Early Childhood Research in the Centre for Research in Education and Social Inclusion at the University of South Australia. I would like to open this oration by acknowledging the traditional custodians of all the lands on which we meet across this virtual space and all Aboriginal people for whom these lands hold significance. I pay my respect to elders past, present, and emerging. I value and respect these nations' respective cultural heritages, beliefs, and relationships with the land, and their continuing importance to their respective nations today. The Centre for Research in Education and Social Inclusion, CRESI, located at the University of South Australia, is one of the largest research centres in the world to focus on generating new knowledge about issues related to educational and social inclusion. CRESI has a long history, actually, of developing and building an impactful research program. Our research seeks to understand the barriers to inclusion and offer educationally and socially inclusive alternatives. And just as importantly, our research articulates with and informs policy and practice. So thank you to our CRESI director, Professor Anna Sullivan, who is the director of the centre hosting tonight's event. And I also acknowledge Professor Sam Seller, our research dean in Education Futures. The Lissa Oration proudly carries the name of Lillian Lissa, an internationally renowned early childhood educator and theorist who worked in Sydney, Adelaide and London. Back in the late 1800s through to 1967 is when she was alive and doing wonderful things on this earth. Firmly committed to the power of early childhood education for transforming lives, Linda Lissa became the founding director of Adelaide's first free kindergarten in 1906 and was the founding principal of the Kindergarten Teachers College established in 1907. Her name was later given to the Lissa Early Childhood and Family Studies Institute at the University of South Australia. I'm very happy to, and excited in fact, to announce here this evening that Lillian DeLissa's significant legacy is being carried forward in an initiative we are developing in CRESI and named in her honour, the DeLissa Early Childhood and Family Studies Research Community Network. The purpose of this network is to bring educational and social innovation, inspiration and benefit to young children, their families and communities and those working with and on behalf of children. In the network, we are envisaging local and global worlds where children, their families and communities can flourish in and across diverse circumstances. And driven by an unwavering commitment to social justice, we're aiming to build such worlds where children are enabled as active citizens to engage in and lead change for collective wellbeing and sustainable futures. The DeLissa Network ultimately will comprise local, national and international participants who want to engage from various disciplines in the nexus of research policy and practice germane to early childhood and family studies research. And we believe that this diverse constituency will enable the co-design of research amongst participants working in a range of sectors and disciplines to ensure end-user-informed research that optimises engagement, impact and benefit. So please do stay tuned for further developments on this front and ways in which you may like to become involved in this network. Now, meanwhile, that's my very great honour and joy to introduce Professor Susan Danby. And thank you, Susan, for agreeing to deliver tonight's Lissa Oration. We are indeed honoured to have you here and have been very much looking forward to hearing your talk. As Susan talks, if you have questions that come to mind, everyone, please pop them in the chat space. Susan will be talking for about 45 minutes and then there'll be about 15 minutes or so time after that for question and answer. So if you pop your questions in the chat space, things might come to mind as you're listening, and Susan very much welcomes that, and that's the way she would like to proceed. And then after Susan has finished her talk, we will then open it up to Q&A. Professor Susan Danby is recognised internationally as one of Australia's leading experts in early years language and social interaction, childhood studies, and young children's engagement with digital technologies. As Director of the Australian Research Council Centre of Excellence for the Digital Child, Susan leads a collective of national and international researchers and partners across government, business and community to work towards the Centre's vision, which is ensuring young children are healthy, connected and educated in a rapidly changing digital age. Susan's research career has been driven by this same vision and cross-disciplinary approach. Her research explores the everyday social and interactional practices of children, investigating their complex and competent work as they build their social worlds. Susan was an ARC Future Fellow and has had numerous ARC discovery projects. She's been a member of the ARC College of Experts and the Early Childhood Australia Digital Policy Group. Susan was awarded an honorary doctorate by Uppsala University in Sweden in 2019 and was named a 2021 Fellow at the Academy of the Social Sciences in Australia in recognition of her absolutely outstanding scholarly contributions to the fields of early childhood and digital technologies. Please make welcome to Professor Susan Danby. Thank you, Susan. We're on mute, so we can't applaud, but know that everyone is welcoming you and thrilled to have you here. So thank you, Susan.
Thank you, and good evening, everyone. And thank you, Pauline, for extending this invitation to present the DeLissa Oration this year. And thank you also for the support of the DeLissa Institute of Early Childhood and Family Studies and Education Futures Unit and the Centre for Research in Education and Social Inclusion and colleagues from the University of South Australia and across Australia and overseas as well. I'd like to also acknowledge the lands on which we're meeting today, and I'll play the video that we play at QUT, recognising all the lands, particularly on QUT lands today.
QUT acknowledges the First Nations owners of the lands on where we gather today and pay our respects to the elders, laws, customs and creation spirits of this country. For thousands of years, the First Nations owners have gathered to share their knowledge and stories. We pay our respects to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples and acknowledge the important role they play within our communities. We recognise their long and continuing connection to country, the lands, winds and waters throughout Australia. We recognise that these lands have always been places of teaching, researching and learning.
And today I'm meeting on Turrbal and Yuggera lands. I also would like to pay tribute this evening to Lillian DeLissa. We celebrate her vision and her legacy. Lillian DeLissa was a key figure in the establishment of the kindergarten movement, as Pauline pointed out, in South Australia, and she has dedicated herself to educating young children. In 1905, she visited Adelaide from Sydney to demonstrate the kindergarten methods that led to the formation of the Kindergarten Union of South Australia. She established and became principal of the Adelaide Kindergarten Training College to train teachers in early childhood education. And she also travelled through Europe to learn the Montessori method, which she brought back to South Australia. Throughout her life, she has been a passionate advocate for early childhood education and also a true pioneer for early childhood education in Australia. I am really excited to talk with you today about children's rights and relate some of this to some research that we're undertaking in the Australian Research Council's Centre of Excellence for the Digital Child. Children's rights sit at the core of the purpose of the centre, and the centre is actively engaged in researching related to supporting children's rights in a digital age. Some of you may have seen a documentary recently aired on Channel 10. So many people have mentioned it to me recently, absolutely alarmed by the program and its claims of harm to children and young people through social media and online platforms. I thought it was a good place to start this evening and our discussions. It's important here to sift through what is being said in this program and where the research evidence lies. Of course, we all need to be aware of the challenges facing children and young people in online worlds. It can be risky. At the same time, we should be working towards making the online world a better place, a safer place. So children are already living in a digital world. The solution to keep them out of the digital world just isn't possible. The digital is everywhere for young children, searching something on Google, playing a digital game, using Facebook to talk to grandparents, using an app. Kate Minnell, who is a research fellow in our Centre of Excellence for the Digital Child, and her colleague Caitlin McGrain are digital media researchers, and they tackle some claims from the documentary, and they write about them in a piece in The Conversation. They think people should approach some of these claims that are in this TV program with some caution. The documentary raises important points about the problems of under-regulation and the need for awareness. Kate and Caitlin also point out that it suggests that the digital device use causes, according to the program, causes attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, in children. It also suggests that online communication causes harm, but in-person interaction is positive. Kate and Caitlin address these claims. They point out that there are many years of research that has not found a causal link. With ADHD, it may be that children diagnosed with ADHD may be more likely to use digital devices. The second claim, that online behaviors lead to increased loneliness and poor mental health, does not have evidence for support. It may be that online interactions may be safe places for staying in touch with family and friends, so evident in COVID lockdown. And some social media may be valuable support for some of our most vulnerable young people. The digital, of course, brings both risks and harms, but also benefits and opportunities through the digital worlds. As educators and parents, we should be concerned and act to secure safe and positive digital engagement. We need strong government regulations. In Australia, the Office of eSafety Commissioner is partnering with the Centre to address matters related to online safety. Everyone here tonight has the responsibility to work towards a digital world that is safe for children and young people. And more than that, we need to offer a way to showcase and highlight the potential to use digital technologies in ways that support children to be safe and healthy and lead a safe and healthy life. The theme of this, of children's rights to be safe and healthy, is the theme for this year's Children's Week. Children's Week is a national celebration of children's rights and citizenship, held in Australia every year to coincide with the Universal Children's Day. Each year, the theme of the Children's Week highlights a particular children's right. The theme for 2022 is based on Article 27. All children have the right to a standard of living that supports their well-being and healthy development. This theme is based on Article 27 of the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the right of every child to a standard of living adequate for the child's physical, mental, spiritual, moral, and social development. Since 1989, since Article 27 first arrived, children's worlds have changed. Children are now living in a rapidly changing digital world. And tonight, we are exploring what supports children's well-being and healthy development in a digital age. The UK Children's Code, or Age Appropriate Design Code, to give it its formal title, is a data protection code of practice for online services such as apps, online games, and web and social media sites likely to be accessed by children. The UK Information Commissioner's foreword points out that data sits at the heart of the digital services that children use every day. For example, a child opens an app, plays a digital game, loads a website, and data begins to be gathered. Who's using the service? How are they using it? How frequently? Where from? or what device. Services that gather information may use techniques used to persuade children and young people to spend more time using the services, to shape the content that they're encouraged to engage with, and to tailor the advertisements that they see. Given this ubiquitousness, how can we create safe digital spaces for children to learn, explore, and play? This code of practice, this UK code of practice, aims to do that. And I think this is really important. They aim to do this not by seeking to protect children from the digital world, but by protecting children living within the digital world. This code incorporates key principles from the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, that the best interests of the child should be the primary consideration in all actions. And this includes the right to privacy and the right to be forgotten, the right to access information from the media with appropriate protection, the right to be safe from exploitation, whether that be economic, sexual, or so on, the right to freedom of expression and thought, and the right to be heard. The right to recreational activities appropriate for the child's age. UNICEF recently noted that 1 in 3 internet users globally is a child, and the internet is embedded in children's lives from their earliest years. The internet, whether we agree or not, is going to affect how young children learn, engage in social interaction, and construct who they are. A few years ago, with Kathleen Smeaton, we explored sharenting, parents sharing images of family life on Instagram, and we identified the categories of sharing that mostly mothers engaged in. Here's an example of one of the Instagram posts that we looked at. The mother had commented on her child growing up, linking it to children's age, stages of childhood. This was actually the first time that I became specifically aware of the impact of children's lives being documented from even before they were born. What does this mean for children and young people as they grow up? What kind of footprint will they have? Certainly for many in this online room, we do not have that online history from before to have to contend with, and thank goodness, I say. But for others and for children growing up, we need to be able to ensure that they have a say in what online presence they want, and choose to delete all or part of their online life as a right for all children and young people. As a centre, we are working to advance children's rights to best understand and to reduce the risk of harm for children when they are online. The centre is invested in children having the right to non-discrimination and to have equal and effective access to the digital environment in ways that are personally meaningful for them. As the UK Children's Code points out, data sits at the heart of the digital services that children use every day. From the moment we wake, we are living within a digital world. In this world, children's privacy and being a digital citizen is everyone's business. Children's safety and well-being in a digital world. And that's our theme for this evening. I'm shifting focus now to the rest of Article 27, which also references children's development. And this is where I'm going to draw on some research that is currently happening within the centre. This research speaks directly to the children's right to engage in recreational activity that is appropriate to the child's age, and the child's right to social development and social relationships. Let's just first quickly, though, look at a couple of examples. Is every child's right to engage in social relationships with family and friends? In COVID, face-to-face social relationships was no longer possible for many. We all remember those times. Messenger Kids is a free app launched in December 2017, and it was very popular during COVID. Children interacted through friending others, and this was monitored by their parents, using a free messaging service through text and video chats, drawing tools, gifts, and so on. Here is an app of a 10-year-old, whom we shall call Maggie, contacting her auntie to stay in touch during a COVID lockdown. Here, Maggie reached out to her aunt through a brief hi, and you can see how she used a GIF to display her emotional state, wanting a hug. The aunt oriented to this through putting into words her desire to hug, which Maggie also responded to, saying that she wished she could give a big hug. And here's another example. Here, this preschool-aged child is playing cards with grandma online through a FaceTime session. Grandma also cooks with her granddaughter online as well. They each cook the same meal, but in the different places. But in fragments like this, the ethno-methodological question, based on some work by Marjorie Goodwin, draws on a participation framework where analytic attention is directed to how social relationships are constructed moment by moment. And perhaps because they happen so quickly, so fleetingly, and because they are so mundane, it is very easy to overlook them. In investigating children's social relationships and digital worlds, questions to ask include: what actions are done? How are activities being organized? How do the activities unfold through talk and multimodal interactions? Investigating digital technologies without taking into account the human and cultural dimensions of social relationships is only ever an incomplete project. I often frame my research questions through ethno-methodological lenses that ask, why that now? How do children use digital technologies with family and peers? How are social relationships built through interactions involving digital technologies? Tonight, we're going to have a look at in close detail at some data of children playing digital games, of some gamers, to unpack this a little bit more closely. So I'd like to focus by looking more closely at digital gaming for young children. Many are concerned that children are playing games online, that this leads to social isolation and social withdrawal and mental health problems. These perceptions, though, are largely not supported through research, especially with children. And so I'd like to share with you a project that is currently underway in the centre that is challenging some myths of gameplay. It is also an innovative study that brings together researchers from multiple disciplines. This project aligns with the overall research question of the centre. Our centre addresses the real risks of the digital world, as we started out exploring at the start of the evening, and also importantly, explore the opportunities and potential of digital technologies for young children. We ask, how can all Australian children be healthy, educated, and connected in a rapidly changing digital age? This project starts from a position that's recognised by the UK Code of Practice Standard. What is in the best interests of the child? And the project also aligns with the UN Rights of the Child in relation to the right to recreational activity. Over the past 12 months, a team of researchers led by Professor Daniel Johnson at QUT has been working closely with LEGO and UNICEF to examine well-being and digital gaming with children. The team is really excited about this project as it involves bringing together different fields of research expertise to together collaborate on this project. Daniel brings expertise in digital gaming and psychophysiological data capture, as does Ella. Manisha brings expertise in technology systems, and Marianne Theobald and I bring expertise in video ethnography, children's agency, and competence as informants of their own experiences. We are collaborating with researchers from Western Sydney University, the University of Sheffield, and New York University, Curtin University, University of Wollongong, and the University of Queensland. There are several phases, and we are involved in this phase two data collection, where we're observing children aged from 7 to 12 years playing digital games. Two video games were chosen: Rocket League, which is a soccer game where the cars are in a stadium, and the cars are actually the players playing soccer, and another one called Lego Builder's Journey. And the children played each game. They're quite different. As the children play the games, their psychophysiological data are collected. Before and after the game playing, the researchers ask the players about their thoughts about the game playing. A couple of weeks later, the players are shown their data that captures their physical responses to the game, and they're asked to talk about, to give an account of what was they were seeing on that physiological data. We are so excited by this study, as we believe that it is the first time in the world where children have been asked about their interpretation of their psychophysiological data. Often it is the software program or the researcher that makes analyses of the data. But here we have children having a say on matters that affect them, not through a software or an adult lens, but through the children's own perspectives. So let me walk you through this now. The devices that attach to the children measure their heart rate variability and electrodermal activity. So that's their moisture level. Eye tracking, their gaze, and voice recordings of what they're saying, as well as facial expression analysis. And this diagram shows where these devices are located on the child. The shimmer is the device that captures the electrodermal activity, the moisture rate, and it's on the arm. An earpiece captures the heart rate. The webcam captures the facial expressions, and the eye tracking software captures the child's gaze. And here you can see what it looks like. These devices were not seen by the children as intrusive. Some children were very experienced in gaming, and they even brought their own controllers, and others came with minimal or no experience. They played singly, and they also played in pairs. So let's return now to the ethnomethodological question. Why that now? We are actually asking the children why that now, as they look at their own data of what they're doing and what the data was showing. But not only does why that now relate to what we're asking the children, we're using this question as a method of analysis to analyze the data. In working with the theoretical standpoint of children's participation and research, we are guided by children have the right to be key informants about matters that affect them, and that this approach requires shifting the analytic standpoint from that of the researcher to that of the child. In other words, children are insiders to their own practice. And we undertook a video ethnography approach using three methods. The first was a culture in action approach, which is an ethnomethodological position. The second is video stimulated accounts. And the third is coding using child-centered indicators that were developed within the LEGO UNESCO Wellness Framework that is still a draft at this time and is not able to be released. And this study is actually working towards looking at those indicators and how they actually stand up. The culture in action approach focuses on how children make sense of what they're doing, including the physical and the social. We ask ourselves as analysts, what is going on here and how is it accomplished? It involves close looking at the videoed multimodal actions of the children and of the technology. The video stimulated account combines video and psychophysiological data. Children are shown a brief video fragment of a psychophysiological data that's theirs, and stimulus questions are used to encourage children to talk about their own experiences and behaviors and their perspectives. The coding approach drew on the indicators, of which there are 8, of the wellbeing framework. And I'll now show some of these in action. So here I'm going to show a very brief video. We have two boys. The one furthest from you is 7 years, and the one closest to you is 11 years. They're playing Rocket League. This is the soccer game where the cars are the soccer players in a big stadium. The more experienced player is closest to the camera. The less experienced child was excited to play, but didn't have very much experience at all and not with this game at all. So I'll play a fragment of this. Take particular note of what the boys are saying to each other and their actions as well.
Oh, we're going to lose. They're going to get the score. Are they not? Oh, well, they were before, but now they're not. Why are they driving it away? They're driving it into their own goal. Oh, well, they didn't get it in, but they were driving it into their own goal. 1 minute more raining. That's good, that's good, that's good. Because we have the biggest score, and that means if the time runs out while we have the biggest score, that means we'll win.
My car is...
They're hitting them in their own goal. Yes, we're going to get it. That's good, that's good, that's good, that's good.
It's great.
Yeah.
I did it, but where did it go?
Oh, I found it. I found it. They're trying to get it in our goal. Oh, I hit it really far.
8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Yes, we're going to win.
We won.
Yeah, we won.
So we're going to play another round of that game.
So... for those of you who have gamers at home, that's probably a pretty normal experience for you. But as researchers, we were absolutely fascinated by these conversations. A culture in action approach investigates how the players themselves make sense of their social worlds through their talk and interaction. And this is known as a situated study of culture in action, whose work by Carolyn Baker and Steve Hester have really informed this particular space. To look at how relationships are constructed in situ and in moment-by-moment interactions. These interactions happen, as we said, so quickly, so fleetingly. It's so easy to overlook them, but video is a wonderful tool to help to be able to review these videos over and over again. They don't capture everything, but they do capture a lot. So we've slowed down these interactions to have a good look at them. A video ethnographic approach illustrates turn by turn how children are engaged through the detailed descriptions of their actions and talk. And here I've put up a couple of transcripts. The first one here, we've got boy one saying, we've got to win, we've got to win. B2 says, who won? B1, well, us, we won. Well, we got a point. I hit the ball. Get it, get it. Yeah, that's good. We need to get it over there into the goal. Yeah, push that guy, that the guy, distract him. Yeah, you distract him. And then we have the second example. 1 minute remaining. That's good. That's good. That's good. Why? Because, oh yeah, it's good because we have the biggest score. And that means if the time runs out when we have the biggest plays, and then it finishes with minute, please be up, please be up, minute, please. So here we have both transcripts showing the more experienced player, the one in the foreground, guiding the less experienced player. In transcript one, it was to direct the novice to distract the team, providing advice about a game strategy. In transcript two, the experienced player explained some of the conditions of the game. He's explaining why the time constraint for this game is good. He says the time will run out and that they will win, meaning that the limited time matters because it won't provide time for the other team to catch up their score. We did not see a shared problem solving towards a shared goal in these examples, but we did see the players orienting to a shared goal of winning. In both transcripts, players were communicating with each other to share strategies and collaboratively participate in the social context of playing digital games. We saw through these video observations and the transcripts, the players' real-time interactions as they unfolded moment by moment. Slowing the action down makes visible the children's strategies and actions during this digital gameplay. This fragment showed a context for peer learning, where children learn from each other through child-child collaboration and instruction. The two boys displayed to each other their expertise and encouraged each other through shared goal agreement and shared humor. And didn't you love the guy at the end? We won! He puts up his hand and we won. Children's participation in gaming practices such as these can transform learning and play experiences and knowledge in peer interactions. After the game, the data were collated, and this is what it looks like. And this is what the children were shown about their own data when we met with them a couple of weeks later. So check out where the child's eye gaze is. And you can see when you look at that screen, you'll see the video at the top, and underneath you'll see that green line that goes up. That is actually the moisture spike. And you can see that it will pop up at particular times, such as winning the game, you might see it pop up then. Or another time we found was when they were told they had 1 minute left to play the game, all of a sudden that spike went up. So let me play you a little bit of this. It's really noisy, so I'm not sure how much you can stand it. You might need to turn your sound down a bit, but I'll play you a little bit so you can see what was being captured and what the children actually saw about their own data. So do you see when you're looking at that where their gaze is and how sometimes their gaze is on the car and sometimes their gaze is ahead? I'll play you a little bit more so you can look at that particularly. And now have a look and see when those spikes are and see what is happening at the time. So if there's a crash, for instance, you'll see a bit of a spike. We'll just play a little bit more. Okay, so that gives you a sense of what the children were doing. You can see the child's face there, see where he's looking and his facial expressions as well through that video. So after a couple of weeks, these video episodes were played back to the child, and we drew upon some stimulus questions from the wellness framework to help us ask some questions to talk with the children and do some probing questions as well. So for instance, there's a competence indicator from the wellness framework. So the kinds of questions that we asked were things like, did you know this game beforehand? How do you think you went learning it? Do you feel that you learned new things? What were they? And there's an empowerment indicator as well. Did you get to make decisions when playing the game and what were they? So there's eight indicators in total. So we're looking for questions. This is from the coding perspective, where we'd look and see how that we could ask questions around those particular indicators. And we've picked out a couple for today. So one of them is around self-actualization. Self-actualization focuses on this question: does digital play provide a sense of purpose and improvement in social engagement and feelings about themselves? So here we have the researcher. This is where the player lost the goal, the other team grabbed the goal, and the researcher saw this as a negative game event, losing a goal. But what happened was this emotions went up, and it was joy that was shown. It was a big smile, very happy, big smile when they just lost a goal. And so the researcher says, well, what happened at that point? The child says, well, I mean, I guess I just lost a goal to the enemy team and pretty on early on in the match, which is like, well, generally, it's generally not the best because it's like they already have a lead over you. But I guess I probably felt joy because we had like met pretty minimal resistance in the app until this point. And it was like, oh, I enjoy it. I'm like realizing the AI can be. And it's like, able to provide some sort of talent. It's a hard challenge sometimes. So here the researchers had originally described this as a negative game event for the child, the loss of a goal. But the webcam showed the child's face filled with joy. He was smiling. The child described his feelings as positive because he had been challenged. Hearing the child's perspective brought a new analytic dimension to understanding this framework. Self-actualization is also an important predictor in children gaining confidence and competence. We believe that this finding is a major contribution to understanding self-actualization. We were actually able to demonstrate through the data and the child's account, this understanding of the child realizing that a challenge, losing a goal, led to a recognition of a sense of purpose because he'd actually had to push himself against the better team, which happened to be an AI team, a bit difficult to lose. So we were really fascinated by this data where it actually spoke against what was shown through the actual game and some of the researchers' observations of what had actually happened. And then here's a second example. This indicator focuses on competence. And the question here is, does digital play contribute positively to children's accounts of their own competences, knowledge, and ability? And here we have the child saying, it was a pretty short play session, but I'd say my strategy has definitely improved a bit with like how to hit the ball and stuff. The researcher says, can just explain like the strategies of the game? Do you choose to go? Child says, well, and also it's like, if the ball is like on the field, do you go to where the ball is now or where the ball is going to be? And then at the start, I was like chasing the ball, but closer to the end, I was trying to predict where the ball was, what the ball was going to be and going to there. The researcher says, oh, okay. And how did that help with your overall enjoyment of the game? Feelings of well-being and enjoyment. Charles says, well, provides a sense of progression, like satisfaction, because it's like I'm realizing that you could do something else instead of what you're doing for. And so it's also like a sense of achievement. So here the player learned to predict where the car and the ball were going to next. This concept of predicting is one of the fundamental understandings for young children in all aspects of their lives, including engaging with texts. So the skill of prediction is often one that's used in reading texts, where you might read to the end of the sentence to an attempt to predict what the word might be that you can't work out. And this player here was looking for these possibilities. His account showed that he was also developing strategies. He was also learning how to make a plan, a strategy for how to play this game. These are life skill concepts that are being learnt in this space. The concept of prediction was evident in the gameplay and was backed up by the child's account of what he was working in towards the game. So again, the child perspective here has been incredibly important in helping him to understand and us to understand what was actually going on in that game. I've only shown a little of the data today, but these data bring important findings for understanding the values of digital games for children through attention to how these games offer opportunities for well-being. I also showed today how digital technologies themselves are the resources through which the data are collected. Use of video and the psychophysiological measurement tools. So being a good or bad gamer is not necessarily age relevant, but rather it's being a member of a knowledge sharing culture. Children's digital gameplay is a social context for learning and practicing social skills, collaboration, and problem solving. Collaborative peer culture is built as the players work towards solutions that require taking each other's perspectives and skills. Gaming creates opportunities for peer learning without an adult presence. Digital gameplay can also be a strategic resource for children's agentic actions that leads to well-being accounts of self-actualization and competence. Competence in gaming was a cultural experience, socially built through guiding and scaffolding. Peer culture involves sharing knowledge and working towards shared goals, as these players did. 10 years ago, Catherine Beavis wrote, "Within a rapidly expanding world, more needs to be known about the interactions between players, games, and technology, and the active nature of playing to better understand what was going on." And this we certainly see happening here. And of course, we need much more work to be able to investigate this further as we go forward. The Research Council Center of Excellence for the Digital Child. We're going to talk a little bit about that now because this work is sitting under that umbrella. And some of you may know a little bit and some of you may not know too much at all. But this is led by QUT in partnership with five universities: University of Queensland, University of Wollongong, Deakin, Curtin, and Edith Cowan University. We're collaborating with 14 international universities and multiple national and international partners. So as I said earlier, our goal is to actively shape children's futures for all Australians by focusing on our very youngest. And our inspiration actually grew from the questions that we were being asked by families, educators, health professionals, technology designers, and policymakers about the role of digital technology in children's everyday lives. The centre is built on a program of research centered on the world's first longitudinal study of young children and their digital environments. This family cohort study, known as ACODA, Australian Children of a Digital Age, is of 3,000 families, and it's designed to provide a broad capture of digital technology use by young children and their families. So our solution is a centre that brings together these different fields, healthy, educated, and connected. And across each of those programs lie multiple projects and programs throughout as well. Also within the center, we have some dedicated children's technology spaces. These technology spaces are physical sites where the researchers and digital technology users investigate concepts and potential technological advances. So they're research and professional learning sites for understanding children's use of a range of digital technologies and to support parents and educators in gaining knowledge about positive digital practices for children. The first one at the top you can see is the Children's Technology Centre, which is at QUT in Brisbane. And the second one you see is the University of Wollongong Children's Technology Play Space. So both these play spaces hold events, workshops, and activities that are open to the public, where children accompanied by family members or educators will have an opportunity to learn, play, and connect with digital technology. So next week, for instance, for Children's Week at the QUT space, there's a stay and play session involving families and children coming on board. And there's similar activities happening at the Wollongong space as well. We have, as I said, multiple partners within the centre. These are our industry partners that involve universities, professional associations, government and education partners, and media and technology and cultural partners. These are so important for us because our partners, and I know Anna's smiling here because Masira is one of our fabulous partners. These partners are so important for us, and they help us understand what the issues are on the ground. Absolutely, what's happening and what do they see as the issues that we need to collaborate together, the partners and the centre, about how to investigate and how to bring about development of guidelines and other kinds of resources and support. We're just so thankful for our fantastic partners, and we've got a couple more that are coming on board in the near future. The latest one we've had come on board is the Isolated Children and Parents Association. They're our newest partner, so we're pretty excited about that. Because one of the areas around the digital divide is incredibly important for us. The lack of access to the digital is so critical for a whole range of reasons, either because of where you are geographically or because you can't get access to digital technology, there's economic constraints and so on. So the digital divide is a very huge issue that we're investing time and energy to be able to try and understand a bit more and about how we can then work with our partners and government and so on. And then we also have our international partners. So we have international partners in the UK, across Europe and South Korea and in the US. And again, we're so fortunate to be working with our international partners who are involved in many of the projects that are underway within the centre. So the centre is also developing resources, and the Digital Child blog is one of these. This platform showcases the centre activity and provides guidance, advice and knowledge on digital childhoods to academic and non-academic audiences, and an opportunity to communicate to policymakers and industry. We've launched this year an international perspective series on the blog. This initiative aims to engage a range of international voices who are currently involved in innovative and original inquiries into digital childhoods. So to wrap up in this presentation this evening, we started with an overview of society concerns about digital online worlds for children and how to keep children safe. This led us to children's rights, Article 27. And then we explored a particular focus on the child's right to social relationships and recreation engagement through digital gaming. We looked at how digital gaming can be a safe place for children and one that supports their well-being. But let's return now to the title of this presentation. What difference does the digital make? So we've identified how children's rights can be supported through self-actualization and competence indicators of well-being. Drawing on children's perspectives and accounts of their gaming showed differences between researchers and children in how they accounted for the data. The analytic lens brought different understandings. How exciting to be able to show this finding, and again makes the case for how important it is to ask and listen to children's views and perspectives. And just as importantly, digital technologies are helping to support the analysis and provide further data to help us understand how these experiences have an impact on children's physical and social aspects of their lives. For an early childhood researcher who studies social interaction to be involved in a project which involves all this technological know-how, it just would not be possible except through a multidisciplinary team. And to bring this rich, diverse team together has been illuminating for all of us. We're learning so much about each other's domains. And while we might have some language difficulties sometimes, because sometimes we do speak different languages, we have such goodwill and desire to learn more about each other's approaches and how together we can build a much more rich, deep understanding of young children's interactions. And I'd like to finish by returning to Lily and Delissa. And remember the photo that was at the very beginning of the children using bamboo pipes to blow bubbles? And I put it up there again. And I do wonder if digital gaming is really so very different to blowing bubbles through bamboo straws. So I'm very happy now to take some questions and comments. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Susan. Wow, your presentation is simply stunning, and the scope of your research. I greatly valued the focus on social development and looking at gaming through the lenses of children as key informants, which only but honours their human rights to be heard and to share their perspectives on what matters to them and what helps to make their life valuable. And I can see lots of implications, not just only in terms of how we understand the importances of digital play for social development, but also in how we can democratise learning, informal education spaces in which children's competence is recognised and their agency really is prized. I could go on, but I won't. I know there's lots and lots of questions that people would like to ask you. So if you would like to raise your... now Anna is asking if people could turn their cameras on if at all possible, that's great. And if you're able to raise your electronic hand so that I can then navigate our Q&As. And I can see that Sam has his hand up, so we'll go to Sam. Thanks, Sam.
Thanks, Pauline, and thank you, Susan, for a fascinating presentation and the ways in which your work is pushing boundaries, I think, at the nexus of the political and the methodological is really impressive. I was particularly taken by the way in which you're working with the psychophysiological data, which can be tricky, and I've seen people collect a lot of that data but not necessarily know how to interpret it in ways that offer new insights. And I thought the way in which you were triangulating that with students' narration of their experience led to that really surprising and I think quite interesting insight about why joy might arise when the opponent player kicks a goal. And I'll be thinking about that one for some time because I really didn't see that coming. So I'm just wondering whether you grappled with any challenges as you were trying to make sense of that shimmer data and whether there were any other surprising insights that arose from the way that you're putting it together with the other data in the project.
So we've had so many challenges you would not believe. We are so, and I should say that we're just still in the process still of collecting data, and we're in the process of starting our analysis. So we haven't gone a long way down this path yet. It's baby steps at this point because we're still working in it. But every day we are surprised. The first surprise, well, originally when we were approached by LEGO to be part of this study, we offered them a smorgasbord of the kinds of work that we could do in the center. And then they wanted to do psychophysiological data. Now, Daniel and Ella have a great deal of expertise in that. But I felt really uncomfortable about, and so did Daniel as well, about just focusing on that physical data without actually looking at other ways to try and make sense of that data. So we went back to LEGO and said, look, we really think that we'd like to involve children in this analysis of the data as well. So that was one of the first issues. Then they came back to us and they started raising questions of ethics around psychophysiological data use, and fair enough. And so we spent a lot of time looking for the kinds of technology that were not invasive for children. And so we had watches at one point, but the watches only worked half the time. And so that data was unreliable. We went backwards and forwards. So we had data technology coming from overseas. We had to wait for that. It wasn't working. We used a place at Chermside. It just went on and on. So you got that kind of surprise around data and how that works. And then we had to work together in a team where we had all these different expertises. So we had to learn. I've had to learn a lot about how to look at physiological data. I've never seen it before. I had to be walked through how to make sense of it. And then similarly, the tech team had to understand about talking with children. So they weren't experienced in, while they talk to their own children, there is a theoretical orientation underpinning of how you engage in research with children, how you go about asking the kinds of questions and how you do the probing questions and how it doesn't. And so you've got to take all of that into account as a theory of how to engage with children. So again, we were involved in all of those multiple learning experiences as well. And then when we had all the data, and I think for me, the really exciting part was when we were talking with the children and having them look at their own data. And we had to, we showed them different parts of their data. They wanted to look at different parts themselves. They go, oh, do you remember, do you have when I did this? Can I have a look at that? So we did all of that as well as they were engaged in that. And then it's now a process of us working through that. I'm not sure I'd use the word triangulation. I think I would say that what we've got is a series of different contexts, research contexts, and each research context brings its own kind of illumination around what's happening. So I would see it more like that than as a way of trying to actually pull it all into one. I think we have rich understandings, but I don't think those rich understandings is just one big rich understanding. I think it's across having to keep, I guess, in a sense, a pure focus around realizing these are different contexts. So for instance, accounts, children's accounts, we don't see them as truth. We see them as a co-constructed activity where the researcher and the children are together collaborating on a particular narrative about what it is that they want to say about that data. Mm-hmm. So again, you know, that's a particular theoretical position that we hold. So so they're all the kinds of things that we're learning about each other and engaging with. And yes, there's been lots of challenges, lots of things going wrong. You can imagine bringing on in all these multiple families. That was really interesting. We had some families, it was in the school holidays. So I think some families thought it was a great thing to do in the school holidays, bring their kids. And some families were so excited because their kids were gamers and they just wanted to see what was the latest. And some children walked in quite arrogant. Well, you know, I'm a gamer and, you know, I'm sure I know more about this game than anybody else. Like, it was really interesting to see their own ways that the children themselves produced a particular kind of identity of themselves as players or non-players. So I'm not sure if that answers your question, Sam, but...
It does, Susan, and I think that commitment to co-construction is opening up really important new possibilities for how we might work with that electrodermal activity data in education. Thanks.
So are you doing some work in that area?
Not right at the moment, but when I was at Manchester Met previously with Rosie, who I can see has her hand up now, there were a lot of people doing that kind of work and grappling with these problems. And I think what you showed with that example is a really instructive set of possibilities for how we might take that work forward.
Happy to do that.
Thank you, Sam. And yes, I my ears pricked up about the notion of co-constructed narrative. That's something that it's a really important stance, I think, that we take when we do engage with children's voices. And I'm so impressed by you surmounting these challenges, all of you collectively, of course. I now see Rosie has her hand up. Thanks, Rosie. If you, yep.
Oh, thank you. Susan, first of all, just thank you for such an inspiring talk. It's always delightful to see you and to see you too, Sam, after a little while. But I've got a related question, actually, that because I'm doing a little interdisciplinary study at the moment as well. And I was absolutely fascinated by exactly the same thing that Sam's drawn attention to. So I don't want to linger on it too long, but I'm not quite sure what discipline it is you're working with that does the, you know, the psychophysiological data like that. And what you've mentioned is how, you know, as an educationist and you know, as a constructivist, you saw the change. You saw a different way of understanding what was going on. But did the people in the other disciplines who you were working with see that change as well? What did they reckon to the children's feedback? Could it be that there might be, you know, quite significant changes in how these data are interpreted across the disciplines, not just within our own realm?
Yes. Oh, yes, absolutely. And I think that's when you bring together diverse disciplines, you have findings that are relevant to specific disciplines. But you also have findings, I think, that cross over disciplines as well. So one of the things that Daniel just said to me yesterday when we were looking at some data, Monday actually, he said to me, you know, I don't think I could ever do any psychological work again without talking to the participants about what they see in the data. Now, I think that is a discipline breakthrough. And again, I would never have thought about using psychological, physiological data because I wouldn't even know how to do it, how to even think about it, conceptualize it. So that's why we have a team that's made up of psychologists, engineers. Manisha is an engineer, technology engineer. Daniel, whose work is in digital gaming, but with adults. He's never worked with children until the centre. So we each bring these different tools, if you like, to it. So I do think we do end up with an awareness of what different disciplines can bring to the table, and then what that allows in a transdisciplinary way.
That's fantastic, Susan. And the implications of that, you know, those different visions crossing disciplines, I think is huge. It's monumental. It's really, really lovely. Thank you.
Thank you. And Susan, you now have me thinking, as I was thinking through listening to your talk, that there not only is there a very rich, you know, insights to be had from the research itself, I think there's a meta research story to be told here too about how you actually do this kind of research that is massive and significant and so rich and yet challenging. So there's a lot for us to learn from that, as well as the actual content of the research itself. I'd now like to turn to Lizzie. She has her hand up.
Hi, yeah, I used to do this research commercially for a usability company where we would do eye tracking and get physiological data while people would play games, as well as other things, looking at websites and things like that. And we found a real difference in the methodology that we used. And I was wondering whether you did, after the person played, if you spoke to them before showing them their physiological data. So you spoke to them once and then you showed that to them and you spoke to them further.
We spoke to them before and after. We spoke to them before they played the game to get a bit of a sense about how experienced they thought, you know, they said they were and so on. And then we spoke to them after the game, really in very informal terms, like, oh, how'd you feel? What, you know, what was great about that? What did you find? Did you find anything that was challenging? Those kind of questions. And then we pulled together the data. And then we did talk a little bit. We had to show them how to read the data. So when we pulled up those, we did many of those interviews on Zoom, actually, because it was easier to get hold of parents and we could show the video and replay it easily and so on. And so there was a learning on everybody's side, I think, about how to actually read that kind of data.
Mm-hmm. And so was the interview showing them the data immediately after, or was that later?
No, that was about 2 weeks afterwards, because there was just an interview. There was a conversation afterwards about, you know, what did you think? We've got those conversations recorded as well. But it takes a little time to get that data kind of into a state to be able to show it to the children.
Oh, okay.
And also we wanted to have a look at the data as well, to see what we could see in it. And it took time to get those appointments in place and things like that as well. So
there's programs that do it in real time, so you can watch as they play.
Yes. Well, we could watch them as they were playing. We could do that, and it was recorded. But it was, again, I think it was because it was already about an hour of their time by playing the two games. We felt that, and they're about 7 to 11 years of age, that we felt that it would be perhaps better to give a break and do that at another time. But would you recommend that you do it straight afterwards? Is that what I understand what you're saying?
Yeah. So once you get used to reading this data, then you can stream the data while they're playing. And so you can see what they're doing, you can see where their spikes, you can see what they're looking at, and you can take notes as they play, so that immediately after, when they've got a memory of their playing, first speak to them to get what any things, and then show them the data and say, oh, look, you know, I noticed you had a real spike here. Can you tell me about what was going on? And then they can, and it's interesting because sometimes you get data where, like, because you show them that those spikes, they will come up with reasons.
Yeah, oh yes.
But sometimes it helps jog their memory to being like, oh, that's right, I got so nervous at that point or whatever.
Yeah, and I think also we were very aware that we didn't want to use a recall model. So we didn't, I mean, I can't remember what I did 2 minutes ago half the time. So why would we, you know, expect that of children? So we weren't seeing these as them having to try and remember what it was that they're, what they were actually doing at that time, but more as a kind of stimulus for the kinds of things that they might be thinking about even now as they were looking at that data. So we were very careful that this wasn't a recall activity, but it was a stimulus to talk more about that particular set of data.
Thank you, Susan. Thank you, Lizzie. Davina, you have your hand up.
Yes, I do. Thank you. Well, I, first of all, thank you so much, Professor Danby. This was a fabulous, fabulous presentation. And as I'm writing my thesis, this is inspiration for me to keep going on and finish it. And thank you so much, organizers. I'm joining all the way from India. So thanks to Zoom and perhaps the pandemic that this is possible. I was wondering if one of your goals is to eventually take all of this and go to policymakers, because more often than not, we have people making policies who don't actually play or live in the digital as children do,
yes.
But then they are eventually actually making policies for children.
Yes.
Absolutely. So how do we do that?
Absolutely. I think, Davina, that's a really, really important question, because we have to speak to more than researchers, and we have to speak more broadly. Our communities are important, but we also want to make a difference, and we need to do that through working with government, with policymakers, and also with tech developers. And it's really interesting. In the center, we've got some great tech developers working with us, like Lego. They're just amazing partners. They're so interested in engaging with us and really focused on what is, and of course, there's a commercial interest, we can't ignore that, but they really are interested in looking at children's well-being as well. Whereas we've had other tech developers come to us, and they basically want to use us as a testing site. Oh, we want you to test this product, and we want you to tell us it's fantastic, and you know, we'll give you some money, and that's great. And we explain to them that's not how we work as a center. We're not there for that purpose. And then mostly they go away after that. Some come back and say, oh, okay, but it is part of that process, I think. But certainly in government, we need to do this. And we've done so far some work. We've actually, because we're a national center with some international partners, we've also been able to provide input into some of the government policy that's happening. So we've written responses to whether it's curriculum and documents. We've done the same, the early childhood statement on digital policy. Many of this happened before the center was established, but many of us in the center were actually part of that and involved in that work. And we also are wanting to work more closely with government in this space. And we're quite hopeful that there'll be opportunities to do that. And we're building ways to do it. So if any of you have some good strategies, we'd love to hear about how you do that effectively. That would be really helpful. And good luck with your work.
Yes, thank you. And I noticed there's a comment here from Claire Kelly, who says the Behaviour Team, Engagement and Wellbeing Department for Education are policymakers, all online with you tonight. So that's fabulous. I don't see any more questions now, and it is getting the time now to close this evening's oration. The time has just flown, Susan, and you have been just so generous with your time in what you have presented in terms of such stunning research and provoking really rich dialogue. And I think we're all going to leave this evening with all sorts of renewed thinking about our own research, even if it's not to do with digital research, as mine isn't, but it's still raising really important questions and inspiration for me. And I think you've done that for all of us. So I thank you very, very much, Susan. And at this point, we would normally present you with a gift as a token of our thanks. So I will do this through gesture. knowing that we do have a gift, and the gift does come from the heart, but it will also come via Australia Post to you, as a token of our thanks, as is our tradition with the Delissa Oration. So if you all want to take off your mutes, if you can, I don't know whether you can or not, I would really just like to give a round of applause to Susan. Thank you very much.
Thank you. It was an honor.
Joining the applause.
I wish everyone a wonderful evening, and thank you all for coming to tonight's Delissa Oration. It's been an absolute joy to welcome you here and to see you all and your interest in the oration in this particular topic. And I look forward to our paths crossing once again. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you for this great honour.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Susan.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Wonderful.